All right, so I recently moved and had to set up a new painting studio, so I thought it'd be helpful to give my best tips on setting up a space to oil paint. All right, welcome to Paint Talk, the weekly show where I sit, have a cup of coffee, and talk about oil painting. If you're new to the channel, then welcome to Paint Coach. My name is Chris Fornitero, and I'm here to help simplify oil painting so that you can get better faster. So first off, I want to say that, you know, creating a good place to paint, or, you know, painting studio, I feel like is an ongoing thing. I feel like there's always something like I'm wanting to improve about my studio, or something that I need to get or rearrange or do something. So just know that things aren't going to be, you know, your ideal perfect when you set up your place to paint. And I just don't want you to put off starting to paint because you're like, oh, I want to wait until I got everything just right and have a perfect place set up to paint. You know, do what you can. The most important thing is just to go and start painting. So the first thing that I recommend you doing is setting up a area where when you're at your easel, you have enough room to step back. This is so important. You know, you don't want to like wedge yourself in a corner or, you know, be in a position where you're stuck very close to your canvas. I would say have at least 5 feet at the least, you know, behind you that you can step back and look at your painting. You know, when I do bigger paintings, when I would paint at that cafe and do that, you know, big, you know, 48 by 60 canvases, I'd actually stop every 10 minutes or so and go walk about 20 feet back and just stand and look at my painting and take it in from that far. Because when I looked at it from that far away, you know, I saw things completely different. So if you're setting up a space, position yourself in a way that you can step back. If you can't, if space is really limited, I know what that's like. You know, I've lived in a small apartment with two other people. So if you can't get 5 feet, you know, at least an arm's length away from your canvas would be great. All right, the second thing is have good lighting. Now, what makes good lighting? I think the two main things are the temperature of the light and how that light covers your canvas evenly. So light, you know, you wanna get light that's as close to daylight as you can. If you have like a good set of windows and you get a lot of good natural light coming into your space, that's awesome. I feel like that's the best. The only thing to be aware of is what direction those windows are facing, because, you know, as the sun moves during the day, how that light comes through and the temperature and everything is going to change, so be aware of that, which is why I think a lot of painters like studios with north-facing windows, because they get north-facing light, I guess, and that can help things be consistent, because, you know, sun rises in the east, sets in the west, so if you're facing north, you never have to worry about sunlight coming directly into your windows. And the other thing is making sure your canvas is even lit. You don't want, you know, spots on your canvas to be really bright and other areas be really dark. It's gonna make it hard to gauge colors and values and everything. And I've actually found the most success with this light that I clamp up on top of my easel. I'll put a link to where you can get this in the description below. Now, I've been through a ton of different lights above my easel, you know, big ones that are bigger than this, ones that are smaller than this. And I really like this one a lot. This is by far the best one that I've gotten. It's perfect temperature of light. It actually has two lights off of it that you can adjust either one. You can move it around. It's got like a gooseneck arm, so you can adjust it that way too. And you can adjust the brightness of each light. And I find it's really helpful to put it above your canvas. I feel like I can control the glare a lot better there. You know, I know there's a lot better way. I've seen Mark Carter talk about this, but his whole thing was rigging up a light, you know, I think it was like 30 degrees up on the ceiling behind you and all that. And I'm sure that is the best way to do things. But if you're like me and you don't have the means to do like a lighting rig on your ceiling, you're gonna have to find different ways. And, you know, everybody's situation is gonna be different. That's another thing that I wanted to say is that, you know, everybody's space is different and you're gonna have to move things and figure out on your own, like what's gonna work for you, where you're gonna get enough light. You know, you're not gonna have glare. If you're working on an 11 by 14 panel, that's gonna be a lot easier and different to light than if you're painting on a big, you know, 48 by 60. So there isn't some one size fits all lighting setup. But like I said, this clamp light on top of my easel I've found to be the most helpful light that I've ever gotten. And I also did buy two lights to use mainly for filming. They're LED lights and you can actually control the temperature. You can control the brightness. They can actually raise up pretty high, and I found those very useful for when I'm painting, especially filming, because I have to have things lit very well to film my canvas. I also need the light to be consistent while I'm filming my paintings, so I don't feel comfortable using light coming from the windows, so I shut my blinds and only use lights that I can control and know will be consistent throughout the painting video. So those LED lights I've really liked using those. I have a lot of control again over the temperature, the height, and the brightness. All right, next thing is be able to put your reference right next to your canvas. Now I've done this by, I got a big TV and I put it on this TV stand that has wheels so I can kind of like wheel it around, and I'll wheel it right next to my canvas. And I've been liking this a lot because it allows me to not zoom in on a photo reference, which I feel like that can get you in trouble a lot of times with focusing on details. And having the TV has allowed me to make my references as close to the real life size I would be seeing them. Like even if I'm doing a landscape, if I was painting a landscape from life and I had my easel and I was looking out to my scene, I can get pretty close with this TV of kind of the dimensions and how big I would actually be seeing it if it was, you know, in a real space. You know, same thing with portraits. I can make someone's head on a TV a life size of a head, and that way it's just the experience is closer to painting from life, which is what I feel most comfortable with. Now you don't have to get like a big TV and wheel it next to your canvas like I did. There's other things that you can do. You know, if you work from a iPad, which I did for a very long time, I highly recommend getting one of those gooseneck clamps that you can clamp onto your easel or, you know, anything else, and, you know, maneuver it and get your iPad right next to your canvas. If you work from a computer, like a laptop, I've done this a lot of times too. And I wish I knew about this one thing back when I did that, but getting a music stand that's a really good idea. You know, music stand, it's cheap. You can raise and lower it. It's got a nice platform so you can put a laptop on there and you can raise it up if you need to be higher. It's just so important to be able to dart your eyes back and forth from your reference to your painting. You know, you don't want to be working from a phone and looking down and looking up and looking down, looking up, or, you know, looking this way. You're just going to lose information. It's going to be hard to compare things. All right, next thing is have good ventilation. I utilize a few things. I have central AC, so I, you know, have fresh air coming in. I have a ceiling fan right above my easel, so I have that moving air. And I also have a air purifier if I ever need to. I have a door that I can open. The key is you want to just be getting old air out and new air in, and you just don't want the air in your studio to be stagnant and sitting there. Because as far as fumes go, the main thing you're probably gonna need to be concerned about is the paint thinner. That's the thing that's gonna have the most amount of toxic fumes. I use Gamsol paint thinner, which is considered the most studio friendly paint thinner, but it still has toxic fumes that you need to be, you know, aware of. So, you know, paying attention to, you know, if your painting space is big and open, you'll have to worry about it less than if you were, you know, painting in a very small, confined, closed off space. All right, next thing is have a drying rack of some sort. I went way too long without one of those, and I was just like leaning my paintings against stuff and, yeah, just sitting out, taking up table space. Now I have this cool rack on my wall that I put a lot of my plein air pieces that are on my panels, and they're really thin panels, so, you know, the shelf didn't need to be that big. And I, you know, put them on there, so it's kind of a display as well. But if you can't do that, I've also used, it's just like a wire rack that they use for like server trays and restaurants to dry those, and you can actually slip in panels really nicely in that. If you have canvases and you don't mind putting little push pins in your walls, you can put a couple push pins in your walls and hang canvases there to dry and a display if you want. You know, you always want to be maximizing the space in your studio, and you don't want anything in there that you don't need or taking up space or being wasteful with how you take up space. You don't want to just, you know, have paintings laying out on a table because you could be using that table for something. And also you don't want wet paintings to get smudged and messed up. So having a good area to put those when those dry, because oil paints take quite a while to dry, is very important. All right, the last thing is put things in your studio that will make you want to be there. Now, don't put anything in there that doesn't need to be in there. Like I said, we need to maximize space, and the last thing you want is clutter in your studio, but make the studio a place that you want to go to. You know, put things around you that inspire you. You know, I have books out, you know, from painters that inspire me. You know, any paintings of mine that I like that I don't mind having up, like the Nick Cage painting here, which I know I need to finish. Little dinosaur action figures that I, you know, used as reference for a painting, I got those up. I just got things that make me feel good, that, you know, I enjoy being in the space. You know, there's enough things to keep you from oil painting. There's enough resistance. There's enough excuses not to go in and paint. And you don't want you not liking your space to be one of those reasons. All right, hope you enjoyed that video. Hopefully you can take this and set up your own great painting space and make some great paintings. If you like this video, please hit the like button and subscribe to the channel. And if you would like to see what I am painting on a daily basis, you can follow me on Instagram at Forza43. I'm Chris Fornatero here telling you to go get painting.